Very good morning to everyone. I welcome all the dignitaries, faculties, professionals, and my dear students to the Career Opportunities and Pathway webinar series jointly organized by Victoria University, Uganda, and Ganpat University, India. We have eminent personalities joined today for this webinar. Welcome all the dignitaries from Victoria University and Ganpat University who have joined us today.
Thank you, sir.
So for today's webinar, we are having Career Opportunities and Pathways in Python. We have with us Dr. Hemal Shah, Head of Institute of Computer Science and Technology. Sir is having over 15 years of experience. Sir has completed his PhD in field of ad hoc network routing issues, primarily focusing on delay tolerant network, routing issues, mobility modeling, teaching on theories of computation, advanced network programming, object-oriented analysis and design, unified modeling language, software engineering, software testing, Linux, and shell programming, as well as advanced operating systems. Predominantly, Sir's area of research has remained in ad hoc networks, routing challenges, mobility modeling in extreme networks, and issues on DTM. Along with it, Sir's focus is also on network mathematics, especially for theories of optimization of graph, probability, Markov chain, and random process, game theory, statistics, and queuing theories. Thank you, sir, for joining us today. It's a pleasure to have you, sir. Thank you, sir. We also
it's an honor to have him powerful profile over there. Now I know who I'll be using when I'm writing some papers on the Markov theory and everything else.
All right, great.
We also have with us Professor Tanvi Puri, basically a computer engineering postgraduate. She possesses more than 10 years of teaching experience in academia with compilers, theory of computation, and data structure as core, and Python as the main subject areas of deliveries. Thank you so much, ma'am, for joining us today.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
I also thank all the attendees who have joined us. I hope it becomes a very informative session and you gain a lot. I'm looking forward, and I hand it over to Dr. Hemal Shah, sir. Please, sir.
A very good morning to all of you. So we are going to have the session on the basics of the Python programming. And now I request my colleague, Professor Tanvi, just to share the screen. And let me take first few minutes to set the agenda. And then post to that, we will straight away kick off with the today's session. Right. So, Professor, can you please share your screen?
Yeah, definitely, sir. Just 2 minutes.
All right. So, here we go. We will have next 120 minutes on the discussion. The agenda for the day is set to, we'll just take a small walkthrough on the Python history. Once we know about, you know, the Python, why it is required, what is it, then we certainly need a tool to work on the Python, right? And for that, we have come up with Google Colab. That's a developer's platform. And you guys can just easily code on this platform. So far, Python is concerned, we will be taking the most basic elements which is required for the programming. And then immediately we wish that you had joined us and experience the power of Python. And we can just utilize next 2 hours to see how effectively we can clear our basics. So for the day, we are setting up the learning outcomes that at the end of the session, at least the takeaways for us, for you people, are gaining the basic understanding of the Python, and you must be comfortable in doing the basic programming. I hope that is, you know, setting up the mindset for all of us. Next. So let me just, quickly ask. And before I ask, let us set down the tone. Can you just go back to that logistics part so that everyone should know as what are we going to do for next 120 minutes? So the logistics are very and pretty clear that we will be keeping your mics and the video, audio and video off. For any questions that you have during the session, please actively utilize the chat option and the chat workspace area. That would enable us to, you know, quickly understand what are your queries, and if required, we will take a pause in between and try to address your query on the spot. So very first question from our side to all of you, that how many of you are familiar with programming? So you can now utilize your chat and give us a very quick response to this question, that how many of you are familiar with any kind of a programming. We are waiting in the chat to see your response. Thank you. Not familiar? So Ishan says he is not familiar. May I request other participant also to at least respond as, are you familiar with the programming or not? Okay. Sorry, B says not familiar. Okay. How about the rest? Are we familiar with programming? I hope you are comfortable in utilizing the chat option. Chat option is rightly available to the Zoom. And the question is in front of your screen, requesting your reply for how many of you are familiar with the programming. Your quick reply would help us to, you know, move further. So it looks like, you know, most of you are just the beginner, and only few of all of you are familiar with the programming. So with that assumption, just let me take a minute. A programming in computer science field is just, you know, automating, writing some set of instruction with which, you know, we can ask computer to carry out the task. And to do the programming, we have to utilize the basic programming elements like variables, like assignment, like for loop, like conditions, etc. And that we will be taking, through the Python session. So Soumya says programming has so many languages. So some of us learned the few of them. Well, what is more important is, you know, learning the most basic part, that is a logic development. Otherwise, the programming languages are just the syntax, right? So the next question, as it has been, you know, shown on the screen, that what is programming, right? So programming is basically writing some set of instructions, right, in a higher level language, like maybe Python or the C programming, with which you can instruct computer to do the task, right, in an automatic way. So why are we writing the program? If that question has been asked, right? Humans are very much prone to make an error when the humans do the repeated task, right? So for an example, if the same task has been given to the human for doing, let's say, 1,000 times, then it may happen so that we make an error. Also, we are not that efficient, and neither we have that much speed in doing the things. And that is the sole reason what we do is we write a code We write a small piece of program and we run that program through the computer, and that makes our life easy. You can execute it faster. You can execute as many times as you want, and it does not make any error, right? So let's move to the next question. Fine. So from here, let me just invite my colleague that she is going to take you understanding that, you know, some of you are familiar with the programming, some of you are not. We will be using the chat option, and then next 110 minutes, we will see how effectively together we can learn the Python programming. Over to you, Professor Tanvi.
Thank you, Hema sir. Good morning to everyone. So here Professor Hema sir has just very beautifully shown that, beautifully evaluated that why and what are the features and Python, so why we are present. So now actually why we are learning Python, so that is the most important question. So actually this is the screen that is visible to you. It is a pictorial like. Actually, we have just divided the programmer into three categories. So one is non-programmer, second is programmer, and third one is Python programmer. So when we just compare that non-programmer, that he doesn't know too much about programming. So if it is a, we can say that he's a layman and he doesn't know about the just basics of programming. So suppose if I am a layman and I have to do some calculations, so what I can do, I can manually take a calculator and do so many calculations. So it will take a long time. So that is the non-programmer category. So that scenario is actually compared to, if you had heard like a Thursday Crow story. So he's just looking forward to just come out with calculations, and this is the non-programmer category. So second comes the programmer. So programmer is the intermediator between non-programmer and the Python programmer. So programmer is actually who knows the basics of programming and who is capable of do programming. So he can use any high-level programming language. He's familiar with C, C++, Java, and any other programming language. So you can see that suppose a crow is sitting here, he's just compared to a programmer. So with his straw in his mouth, he's just picking out some water from, and it's easy to grasp things. So that means a programmer is easily, with the help of some high-level programming language, he's just easy to code. So we can do programming even with the help of some other languages. But when Python is introduced and when Python is compared to other existing high-level languages, so you can see that Python programming is just sitting on a chair. So he is looking so cool and relaxed that he has a just flexible mode. So for example, he is just putting his straw on a pot and easily he's grasping things. So that means actually what this picture indicates that Python programming is very much simple to do. So everything is available, it has very flexibility, and it is very easy to code. So we can also say that Python programming is a fun. So here you can see, so at the end of this session, you will come to know and you can just compare the Python programming with the other languages, that how, in fact, the Python programmer is someone, for example, we have put a question in the starting, that how much are you familiar with Python? So most of the participants have said that they are just beginner in programming. So no issue at all. So Python is a very simple language and very easy to code. At the end of the session, you are probably able to just type the program and you can run the program. So that is the actual description between the programmer and the normal Python programmer. So now comes the history of Python. So when and why? Actually, the Python, the developer of Python was Guido von Ryssum. So Python was discovered, Python was invented in December 1989. So actually what Rusam was trying to do, he was just trying to write a new interpreter for a new scripting language that would appeal to a Unix and the C programming language. So that must be an appealing to an hackers. So because actually he is just trying to intermediate between the Unix and the C programming language. So he is writing an interpreter for it. So interpreter is like a translator. So I'm just giving you a very simple and basic example of interpreter. So for example, you have some native language and we are also having some native language. So suppose you are coming to India and everyone is speaking in his native language, or everyone is speaking in Hindi. So what facility you just require? You need a translator, you need an interpreter that will just translate line to line and show you the code and show you that actually what the next person is saying. So that is the meaning of translator or interpreter. So what Python, what Rosam is trying to do, he is just trying to invent an interpreter that looks appealing to the Unix and the C programming language. So now why are you, might be a question in your mind that why the name Python? So the name Python is just on the British comedy troupe Monty Python, because the developer Rusam liked the British comedy troupe Python, so he just named his programming element that Monty Python. So there are many versions of Python are available. Earlier in the stages, the Python 2.x, and now the Python 3.x is introduced. So Python 2.x was introduced on 16 October of 2000, and later on the Python 3.x was introduced. So Python X, that means X 1, 2, 3, it can be anyone. So, but now we are working with the current version of Python, that is the Python 3.8.3. So that is the most important. That is the Python features. So this slide is comprising about Python features that we are going to use here. So first one I have already elaborated in the previous slide, that it is very easy to code. So in case of beginner, so beginner can just find it easy to code. He can learn the whole programming basics in just couple of days or in just a couple of hours. So that is very easy to code. And second one is, it's a high level language. So what is exactly high level language? That means it is easily readable to the programmer, it is easily readable to the user, and it's very close to the human beings. So for example, just I am writing some code and it should be easily just understandable. So it has some understandability feature. So that is the high level language. Next, it is open source and free. So normally it is the most because it pays nothing. So it is very free to download and it is an open source. So open source, that means, yeah, it is an open source. So its environment is just open to everyone. So everyone can contribute to its development. Next, it is a extensive array of library. So extensive array of library. So that is the very biggest feature of Python. Because Python supports so many huge set of libraries that has already been developed. And if suppose we are just using very huge libraries, we have to do simple import library function, nothing else. So we can use, suppose we are writing, we are working with sets. So we don't need not to write for the union operation, complement operation. So need not to write so huge lengthy code. We have to simply just use the already built-in libraries, and then this built-in library code is replaced, and finally we will get the solution. And this huge extensive array of libraries also used in various applications of Python. For example, we can easily work with machine learning, with data science, with TensorFlow, and so many applications. And last one is highly dynamic. So highly dynamic, it's just a feature. If we suppose we compared with the earlier high-level programming languages, for example, if you're aware of C, C++, and Java, so in that kind of languages, we have to first initialize the variables. We have to just tell the compiler that what type of variables we are using. So, but here, the in Python, so this feature actually, we can just make the type of variables during runtime. So no need to just declare variable types in the initial starting progress and declared as a global variables. No need to do that. So we can just declare variables during the runtime, and compiler or interpreter can easily just find out that what is the type of the variable that we are using. So that is means that is the function of highly dynamic. So in short, Python has five main features that we are just cover up, we are trying to cover up in this session. First one is easy to code, and second one, it is open source and free. So it is a high level language. Third one, we are going to make use of various libraries that are already available to us. And fifth one is highly dynamic. So next is the applications of Python. So where Python are using in current scenario, what are the domains of Python? So actually I have already discussed that Pythons are using in various, it has very wide applications. For example, we are dealing with, if we are dealing with machine learning, if we are dealing with data science, if we are dealing with gaming and other activities also. So these are the various applications. For example, if I have written a Civilization logo, so it is a popular game. So this gaming is just, is the whole setup is in Python. Then Instagram, so Uber and Spotify, so Dropbox, EVE, these are the various applications. These are the various domains where you find that nowadays Python is using. So that is the most important reason. So when we are dealing with the, especially with data science and TensorFlow applications, so the main preference for the programming language is the Python. So that is the need of actually Python. And that's why we are just, we want that you are just familiar with Python. So can you please tell me, that is the simplest question that we have already discussed in the previous slides. So who is the founder of Python? You can use your chat box for answering this question. You can quickly use your chat box for answering this question.
Hi guys, we hope that know you are enjoying this session. Would be great if you can quickly respond, who is the founder of Python? Yeah, great.
Yeah, very great, nice. Francis.
Good.
Yeah, other participants, anyone? Okay, great. So the founder of Python is Guido von Rosen. So that is a very simple and basic question. So now let's move on.
Okay. A lot of quiz going to come during the session. So remain alert, remain active, and let's enjoy.
Yeah, good. Very good. So keep going on.
Thank you, Fred. It's the right answer.
Okay. So actually, we are just saying that we are focusing on hands-on session and Python. So to conduct Python programming, so we are using the developer's platform, that is the Google Colab. So actually, these are the various basic features of Google Colab. Why we are using Google Colab? Because Python is already free and it is open source. We can just download Python from python.org site. But still, we are using Google Colab because we don't need to download anything. Already the setup is provided in Google Colab, and it is 100% cloud. It is using the current version of Python, that is Python 3. And the next, the last two lines that deals with the, for example, it supports various hardware accelerator. For example, it is supporting GPU and TPU. So if you heard about that, GPU is the graphical processing unit, and that required for the just very data science projects. And if we are dealing with the TensorFlow projects and deep learning projects, so for that we require tensor processing unit. So I just want to just minimize this, that Google Colab is providing all the hardware facilities to run our program. So it is already set up of environment that is providing every facility and every possible package. So that is the reason we are using the Google Colab. Okay, so now let's move to the hands-on session. So before moving to hands-on session, so first I will show you that how Google Colab is used. So I'm just minimizing the screen. So first prerequisite for this Google Colab is, please just open your Google Chrome. All of you, please go to your Google Chrome.
Can you open one new tab for a while so they can follow your
steps? Yeah, actually, sir, this sheet is already open in my Google Chrome. So I'm using this Microsoft Edge. So they can just... It will take just a while.
Yeah.
I'm just signing out from this.
So guys, now the hands-on starts, and we want all of you to get sync with us. Please do follow the steps as been mentioned by your professor. So step number one, we have to open the browser that is available to us. And there you please type Google Colab, C-O-L-A-B. You have to just type.
And the prerequisite is that you should also have a Gmail account.
Yes.
So until and unless you don't have a Gmail account, you are not able to just log into a Google Colab. So
please be little active on the chat. And once you are ready, once you have logged into your Gmail account, once you search Google Colab, let us know in the chat. Yeah. Can you please type here?
Actually, sir, I'm signing out because
that's okay.
Else they don't understand them. Okay, so here our first step is just to type Google Colab.
Wait.
So when we type Google Colab, please click on the first link. So here we are clicking on the Google Colab.
Yeah, please wait.
Okay.
All of you guys, please, be quick on the chat. Are you able to at least get the Google Colab? Yes, if you can reply back in the chat, if you are getting the Google Colab, would help us to move to the next step.
You can even raise your hand if you are getting it. Just raise your hand. No need of replying also. Yeah.
Okay. So three of you are getting. We are just waiting for some more hands to get raised out of this. And then we can move on. I guess some of the attendees are still experiencing a problem. Steps are very simple. You have to just go on Google, type Google Colab. Click on that. And you must have your Gmail account, right?
Yeah.
Yes. So, yes. Are we all there? Can we move on?
So anyone is facing problems
in this? Soumya, Umar, what about you? Are you able to follow us? Let's move on. Yep.
Okay. Yeah. So actually, when we just open the Google Colab, there are so many options. So first, we will go to our file. And we are working with a notebook. So just open new notebook, because this is a new notebook you are just creating. So just click on the new notebook. So shall I click on the new notebook?
I think yes, we should.
Okay. Okay, so see, when I just click on the open new notebook, the message arises, you must be logged in with a Google account to continue. That means you should have a Gmail account. So first, please log in into your Gmail account. Then you can able to access your Google Colab. So I guess everyone is having Gmail account. You can write down in the chat box if anyone is not having a Gmail account. Because for that you have to create a Gmail account.
Either you can raise your hands or type in the chat. We presume that you have got the Gmail account, which is a minimum requirement to go and kick off, you know, the journey with Colab. Yep. Thank you, Sila. Yep. How about the rest? I presume that all of us have got a Gmail account, right? Yes. Thank you, Francis.
Okay.
How about rest? We are waiting, guys. If you can be a little quick in replying, we can move on. So fine, let's move on, Professor.
Actually, sir, there is a query from Technospark.
Okay.
Please help me out, I am lost. So actually...
Wait a minute.
Yeah,
TechnoSpark says, please help me out, I'm lost. Yeah, so the steps are pretty simple. What you have to do, you have to just go to your browser, open, let's say, the google.com, or just for the Google search, and there you have to type Google Colab, C-O-L-A-B, correct? And click on Colab. It will ask you to log in to your Gmail, and we presume that no, you are logging through the Gmail, right? And we are just waiting there. I hope it makes it through. Yeah, thank you, Fright, for confirming. Thank you. Yes, so can we move on? Yeah.
So I'm just closing this because already the sheet is open in my Google browser.
Okay.
So I'm just moving on this. Because for this demo purpose, I'm just open this Microsoft Edge.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So guys, here we are starting our hands-on session. Just hold on.
We have to go extremely slow as the attendees are just picking it up.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So guys, you are just when you open a new notebook, so there is an option on the extreme right hand. So just hold on, I will just hold on. So okay, so on the right hand side there is an option of connecting. So once you connect, you can just easily run and type the code. So first thing, yeah, very basic thing you should know, that in which version that you are using, in what Python version you are using exactly. So actually, in this notebook, we are working with code and text. So each code and text is written to be in a cell. So when I click on this, this is known as a particular cell. So I have to write the code in this text. So on the right hand side, you can see there are much many options. For example, move cell down. So with the help of this, we can move the cell up and down. So there are two arrows in the upward and the downward direction. So you can also link to a cell. There are also, you can add comments. So there are some settings. For example, you want to delete this. So you want to delete this cell. You can just click on this delete button. So now the first, I'm just trying to find out that what is my version that which I'm using. So first is the command. Please type side by side import sys. So we have to import the packages. I have already said that various built-in packages are already provided in Python. So that is one of the package, import sys. So just please press enter, import sys. Just 2 minutes, I guess. I have not connected to a Google Colab. Just 1 minute. So the next step is just type sys.version. Please write 2 lines in your particular cell. Okay, so now there are 2 options to run any cell.
There is a question, what is library? A library is, you know, a set of a predefined function. For an example, we are using this Colab, right? So which is 100% on the cloud. And when we say import sys, now the sys stands for the system. It's a library. And in this system library, there is a function. What is that function name? The function name is version. And what is we are trying to do with this? So first of all, just to kick off, we are trying to understand that which version of the Python we are currently working in. I hope that makes us clear that what exactly we are doing. We are presuming that all of you are on the Colab. You have already got connected. And as instructed by the prof, please write these 2 lines of the code where we are trying to do what? We are just trying to understand on which version of the Python we are working with. Yep.
Okay. So I guess everyone has written these 2 lines of code. So now the question is how to run this code. So there are 2 ways. Either you can just click on this run. So that is the run cell. Either you can click on this, or the second option is to press Shift plus enter. So again, I'm repeating this. There are 2 options to run any cell. So first one is run cell. You can directly run cell here. So I'm clicking on this. So you can see the processing is going on and the output is displayed. So that is the version which we are using in the Google Colab. So Google Colab is providing 3.6.9 version. Actually, the latest version is 3.8, but still the Google Colab is providing the packages, providing the facilities environment for the 3.6.9. But still we can work everything in 3.6.9 version.
So are we all able to, you know, do this? Okay. So TechnoSpark is asking, I have opened the browser. How do I log in? So TechnoSpark, you have to just go to the Google. Please go to Google, right? And type Google Colab. And in meantime, all other attendees, if you are able to do so, raise your hands here or put yes in the chat so that we can go to the next step. Thank you.
Okay, so there is one more query in the chat. Okay,
yes.
So yes. Okay, so have you logged in the Google Colab TechnoSpark? Okay, so I'm okay. Here.
I guess you have to go once again to that
no problem, sir.
Another browser.
Okay.
And why don't you take up an incognito mode and show them so they will be able to understand.
Okay. So I'm just opening a private window and again explaining the step that how to just log in into this Google Colab. So it will just take 2 minutes. Hardly it will take 2 minutes. Okay, so first, please just open your. So I'm just typing. Just wait.
Yes, so two of them have already confirmed that they are on.
Okay.
Rest, let us see.
So you have to just type, you have to just search for the keywords Google Colab. So once you just click on this Google Colab, so please click on the first option, on the first link. So I'm just clicking on this Google Colab. So once you click on this, okay, so this type of screen is open. So you just have to go to file and just click on the new notebook. So once you click on the new notebook, because I have not logged in my Gmail account, so because the prerequisite is to, it should be logged in with the Gmail account. So I'm just clicking on OK. So it will ask to sign in into your Gmail account. So whatever you are having Gmail account, please log into your Gmail account. And then you are able to access the notebook that you have recently opened. So you can see once I just log into my mail ID. Okay, see guys. So when I have just logged in into my Gmail account, so it will be working. The new notebook is open. Okay. So I guess everyone has just opened the Google Colab new notebook. Okay. Okay, so assuming that everyone is just compatible with this Google Colab, so I am moving forward. I'm just moving to our first program. Okay. So here we have typed the two commands, import sys and sys.version. So these two commands, why we write these two lines of code, just to know the current version of Python that we are dealing with. So we are working in 3.6.9 Python version. So up to that, it is, I guess, everything is fine. So now next, in the previous slides, I have already discussed many times that Python supports a extensive libraries, extensive set of built-in libraries. So if we just find out the how many libraries are there, so you can just write a command, pip. So pip is also used In for example, you want to install anything. For example, if you're you can work with TensorFlow, so you have to just pip command. So pip command is actually used to install any package. So I'm writing just pip and freeze. So this command will show that how many built-in libraries are already available in Python. So what you have to do, you can just run this cell. So I'm running this cell. Okay, so great. You can look at this, guys. So how many Python libraries, how many Python packages are already available that are used for different purpose? You can see how many packages are there. Okay, so that is Jupyter, Kaggle, and Keras for TensorFlow, Lucid, Matplotlib, that is for plotting graph, NumPy, that is for array calculation, OpenCV, Pandas, so much. So there are so many application packages that are already available in Python. So we can use any package that is given here, SkyPy. So there are too many Python libraries are available, that is PyTorch. So there are too many libraries. So this command we have used only to just know what are the various types of libraries that are already available to us. Okay. So now we are moving to our first basic program of Python. Okay, so suppose you want to add, you have written two lines of code, and if you want to write a code, you just click on this plus code. So a cell will appear. For example, this cell is appear. So you can write the code in between. And if you are clicking on the text, only you can write text. For example, I am writing print. So that is the text. So you can change its toggle heading. You can display in bold. So there are too many options. So when you just click on the text plus text, you can only write text. You can't able to write any code. You can't run this code. So when you have to just type your code, you have to compulsory click on the plus code. Okay, so that is the, I'm going to delete this. You can delete this by using this. Okay, so our first program is simply to print any statement. Okay, so I'm writing this print. So I will step one by one. What is this print and what is this argument? Okay, so I have written print hello everyone. So actually what is print? Print is some function. Okay, if we talk about in basic language, so if in English we can say what is function. So function is nothing, that is the, actually we have to perform some task. That is, for example, we are eating something, we are cycling, we are reading something. So that are the basic functions. So for these, for example, it can be understood with the help of a very common example. Suppose you are going to some ATM machine. So in ATM machine, there are two, three options. I'm taking only two, three options. One is deposit, second one is withdrawal, and third one is suppose to check your balance. And what is actually, if you are clicking on deposit, so what will happen? So you can consider it as a function. So behind deposit, there is some lines of code that will execute and show you the output. And suppose in a day there are thousands of transactions once in a day. So is it feasible to write for every person? Is it feasible to write a deposit function each and every again and again, again and again? No. So in terms of programming language, so function is a reusable code that we can use later on. So once we just write function, the code behind the function, so here is the function I am using, print. So print is a function. So already in Python, so some lines of code are written for this print. So once I run this statement, the code behind print will execute and it will show the output. And the inside this parenthesis, I have written hello everyone. So that is the argument I have passed to function. So when I just run on this program, when I just run on this cell, so what it will show? Hello everyone. So that is our first program in Python. So you can just imagine that how simple is to write a program in Python. So I have now, already, sir.
Can you all guys try? So it is, you know, when she was explaining about the function, it is just like, you know, inserting the key into our car and turning the engine on. Now, when you turn on the engine, right, lot of parts get started, but the engine starts. So the function actually does its job and it gives you an output. So in that case, the output is the engine starts. Here, the output of the print is you can able to see something on your screen, right? So we now want all of you to try the first function, print, and see, are you able to execute and get hello everyone? A moment you are done with that, please use the chat or raise your hands. In between, if you need any assistance, feel free to put your question in the Q&A or chat. Yeah, thank you. We will be waiting. So Francis, you are able to do it. Great, good. How about the rest? We will be giving you some couple of minutes, you know, so that you can at least attempt.
So yeah. Wow, it works. Good.
Okay. Great. So there are responses coming. Very good. So Sori is replying, Soumya. Yeah, very good. So so the attendees are just getting sync with us. That's fabulous. How about the rest? If you need any assistance, please let us know, even if there are queries. If you are unable to do, we would be more than happy to assist. We want all of you to learn and utilize this time very effectively, so that you will have some sense of satisfaction that you guys have at least done something by your own, and that will take you to the next level.
Okay, so assuming that guys, everyone has done with this statement?
Yes.
Okay, so we can do just slight changes in every bunch of code, every line of code, and then we will enjoy it. Then we will see then what is going to be happens. So suppose this is the argument that we have written in the parenthesis. So we are just printing this string. So in between this double quotes, it is a string kind of message that we are printing. So this argument I have written in double quotes, but still you can also write this in single quotes. So let's see what will happen if I am replacing double quotes by single quotes. So I am just replacing the double quotes with single quote. So please once again, and suppose if you want to clear the output, so where is the output? There is the option cross. So just click on this clear output, once again run this cell. Okay, see, what is the output? Same output. So there is nothing difference. If you write double quotes, if you write single quotes, the result this thing will be the same. So that are the very basic differences that you should know. Okay, so done. If anyone needs any kind of assistance, please raise your hands or you can write down in the chat box. So shall we move to our next program, next component of our Python programming?
We love your quick response, right? So if you are done, please acknowledge us. We will move further. Yep. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay, guys. So there is a one query in the chat.
Wait a minute. Yeah. Soumya asking, will you please explain why we put brackets?
Yeah, actually brackets that we used for arguments. That in, look, there is one more thing. For example, if you are working with any programming language, there is some syntax of programming language. So there is some format we have to follow. So whenever we are writing print, whenever we are taking input, we have to just, because print is a function, and every time with a function, we have to write this parenthesis. So in case you are not able to get in, you can just also write, for example, I can also write this help and print. So this command will assist you that what is the format. Okay, so actually it will show you the already built-in functions. So it will display everything about the function that you are using. So when I have typed help, so Google Colab will help me to just writing this argument. How can I pass this argument? So it has written print value, comma, and separated. And so this is the format that we have to follow. So in short, it is a function. And after function, we have to just invoke this parenthesis. We have to pass some argument.
The question is from the Soumya that if we don't space, what will happen? Because that makes the student get error. So that's obvious, Soumya, because we have to follow the syntax, right? So for an example, if you try writing a print, hello everyone, without this brackets, you will get an error. What is the reason? The reason is pretty simple, because it is a format. It is as good as like, if you want to start your car, you have to insert the key of the car. If you insert the key of your door, right, it's not going to, you know, start the engine. It is going to give you error. So similarly, if we don't follow the syntax, we will get an error, right? Okay.
Okay. So shall we start?
I hope we are able to make you understand. Yes. Okay, great.
Okay. So next part is the variable. So I have discussed that it is a highly dynamic programming language. Yeah, it is a highly dynamic programming language. But still, we have to define the variables. So how variables, we can define variables. So actually, there are four kinds of data types. So first is integer, second is string, third one is float, and fourth one is boolean. So integer, that means our integer numbers that we are dealing with, string that we recognize by single quotes or double quotes, that is a sequence of characters. And the next one is float, that is the decimal numbers. And the last one is boolean. So boolean is actually having two values, either true or false. So how can we define variables? It is a very simple way to define variables. For example, I'm taking three variables, x, y, and z. So x is equal to 10. So 10 is a simple integer value. Okay. So next, I'm taking y. So suppose y is some floating point number. So you can take any number that is having decimal value. So I have taken 67.89. Now z. Okay. So z, I'm taking a string type data type. So z is the name of variable, and the variable type is taking I'm as string. So I'm typing guni. Okay. Hope you understand. So I'm talking about variables. So variable is what? That is having some values that we are going to use during our program execution. So suppose I am writing program for to calculate the area of circle, to calculate the interest rate. So I am using some variables, so that variables are to be defined. So I have taken some values, randomly I have taken some values. X is equal to 10, that is of integer type. Y is equal to 67.89, that is our floating type. And Z is of string type. You can write it in double quotes, either you can write in single quotes. So when you run this cell, okay, so when you run, you see that no output is there. The reason is that because we have nothing we didn't write any print statement. Because output is just going to be happening where we have written print statement. So in this code, I have written three lines. So I have declared three variables, but no print statement is there. So in case you have to print the value of three variables, X, Y, and Z, so the format is just simply write print, that is your function. So just write out three variables separated by comma, X, Y, and Z. So that is the very basic program. So when you just run on this cell, the values will be printed. So the value of X is 10. It is separated by some space. Then value of Y is printed, then by separated by some space, then Z value string is printed. So guys, hope you have just executed these two programs. If we don't space, but will happen because that makes student gets error. Example students, some participants are not there for such errors.
We have to wait, I guess.
Yeah.
Are we all able to do this? If you can quickly respond.
Yeah, we are waiting for your responses, please.
I hope you know what is variable, right? The variable is the one to which we can assign the value and it can keep changing. Suppose that value does not change, we term that variable as constant. So are you all with us? Are we able to do it? Are we getting the output? Any response in the chat? Yes, okay.
Yes, from Soumya. She's saying yes.
Yes, great. How about the rest? Francis, then Kamya, are you guys getting?
Yeah, Francis, what problem you are just facing in this executing this program?
Okay, sorry. Thank you. Sorry. Francis say have failed. Can you please let us know what is a error that you are getting? You can just put your code here in the chat. Would help us to understand if you are making any mistake. Francis.
Yeah, there is some query in question answer. I am lost like two steps back.
Okay, so you can catch them up and let me see if there is anything coming in the chat. No. Yes, Francis, are you able to come out of the error? See, these are the most basic elements, and once you know how to write, how to declare the variable, how to execute the code, how to declare the variable, how to assign the value. Believe me, you will find and feel that the programming is just like a fun. Yes, so can we move on, all of you? If you can raise your hands, then we can quickly move on. I guess they are still doing it.
Yeah. Actually, you don't need, Francis, please don't write anything in double quotes, because already the variable is assigned a value and you are simply printing the variable. So because you have written double quotes x, y, z, so just simply write print x, comma y, sorry, x, comma y, comma z. That's all, Francis. Because actually, why we write the single quotes and double quotes when we have to just display the strings as it is? Because it is not a string, it is in variables. So there is a format of print I have already discussed. We have to follow some syntax. Yeah, Francis, you have a name error. You can just copy paste your code. You can paste your code here. Yeah, some participants have a connection problem, internet connectivity problem.
See, this is a unique opportunity for all of you to learn, right? So please try to get sync with us. Let us not let okay, let me know that are we able to catch up or not. So right. Francis is writing print xyz. Okay, then still he is catching up in the error.
Yeah, Francis, is there any output generating from this statement? Are you struggling with some error? I guess we shall move on.
Yes, yes.
No, I am stuck with the name error. Yeah, Francis, you can just type your code here. You can just paste your code here so that I can resolve your issue. What variables you are using and what variables you are printing, that should be the same variables. For example, if you are printing x, y, z, and the same variable name is to be taken in the above code. So suppose you are taking printing x, so x variable is somewhere, is just initialized.
No, let us go one step back. Francis, have you declared x equals to 10? Y equals to 67.89 and Z equals to some string. Here we have, put up Guni. And then are you writing, the print statement? Then most likely you should not catch up with any error. I'm stuck up with the name error. So Francis, can you please write what is the code above print XYZ? Have you declared these three variables? Yes, it worked. I had made a mistake in, yes, that's what.
Okay.
Correct. Fine. Very good. Great.
Okay, Francis. So your issue is resolved. So we are moving to our next program. So in our variable, the next step comes the multiple declaration. So we are taking the same example that we have taken above, x, y, and z. So same variables, if you want to display as a multiple declaration, for example, in single line, because in the above what we have done, we have taken x is equal to 10, then we press enter, then we have taken y is equal to floating numbers in the next line. But now here what we are doing, I have taken all the variables in the single line. So suppose if you are declaring all the variables in the single line, this is known as multiple declaration. So what is the format? You have to follow x, comma y, comma z. That means the number of variables separated by comma is equal to their respective values. That means the x value, so x value is 10, y value that is separated by comma and 67.89, then z value that is the string. So already we have taken Guni. Okay, done. So guys, please type this code. Okay, so once you type this code, okay, so no output will be generated. What is the reason? Because until and unless you don't write the print statement, it will not print anything. So in case you want to print any variable, any values, so you have to write the print statement. So what we are going to do, we are writing print, I'm sorry, it's a, we have to write in lowercase letters. So print, same statement I am repeating, x comma y comma z. So I'm just running this one line of code. So it is printing the same output. So from the above two programs, you can just visualize that there are two methods of showing variables. There are two ways of assigning variables. So one is the one, either you can do in a single line, you can take one variable, then press enter, then come to the next line. Or second option is that you can go with a multiple declaration. So it will reduce your time, save your efficiency, and so on. So I'm just taking x, y, z in a single line. So same output is generating. So are you getting? Okay, so there is one chat. So can one start from multiple declaration or from variable without the first? Yeah, definitely you can start with a multiple declaration. There is no need that you have just start with these lines of code. You can obviously start with the multiple declaration. So whenever we are dealing with the lengthy programs, we will do, obviously we will go for a multiple declaration. Yeah, is there any query? Is there any questions from your side? So that's Galaxy Tab 4. So are you getting, there is a question, there is a query from Galaxy Tab 4.
No, that was a way back. Question was way back.
Yeah.
So if they have done with this part, then we can move on.
Okay, no problem. Okay, so here I am also writing this code. So now, the next statement. Yeah.
There is a query. Are we not going to declare any variable name in the Python?
Are we not going to declare any variable name in Python? Yeah, actually, it is a dynamic programming language. So this is the way that you can declare variables. But once we just start with our programming session, that means 5 to 6 lines of code. So here we are declaring variables at runtime. There is no need to declare the variables in this way. You are just taking input from a user at a runtime. So we will discuss everything in detail. So Windows does not ask for Gmail, but allows going ahead and has untitled. So IPNB instead of Python programming, is it the same? No, actually, Soma, what is the reason that this Python programming is the name of your notebook? So once I can change, for example, I'm changing this Python programming to, you can write anything. That is the name given by you yourself. That means you are giving some specific name to this notebook. So I have given this name as a notebook, as a Python program. You can give any name. So what is IPYNB? It is the Interactive Python Notebook. So I stands for interactive, PY, that is our and NB stands for our notebook. So you can give any name. If it is displaying as untitled, please you can change the name. Okay. So one more thing. I have declared three variables X, Y, and Z. I can also check the data type of various variables. For example, I have to check what is the data type of X variables. So what I have written type X. So type is again a function. So in between function, I am passing argument, that is the variable for whom I just want to find out what is the type. So I am again, okay. So what is the value of X we have taken above? We have taken the value of X is 10. So what here it has printed? That value of X, type of X, that means data type is integer. You can just perform the same by changing the variables. You can change the variables Y and Z. So suppose you are just checking the data type for Y. So you can write Y. The data type will be changed, that is float. So if I am writing here Z, so data type is string, str, that is the short name for string. So this is the way how to know the data types for your variables. Okay, so shall I proceed further? Any query from your side, you can raise your hand. Yeah, there is a. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Okay, so I'm taking the next program, that is a swapping of variables. Yeah, if someone is familiar with C, so for swapping of variables, that means we are changing the variables' values interchangeably. So for example, we are taking two variables, X and Y. So we are both swapping their values. So if I want to write this code in C, so I have to write the 4-5 lines of code. But if I'm taking as a Python programming, so it is a simply one line code. So here you can just analyze, you can just quickly analyze the changes. For example, suppose I'm taking two variables that are already taken above, X and Y, and I have to interchange both the values. So I'm just writing X comma Y is equal to, now the values will be interchanged. So after this line of code, what will be going to happen? The value of Y is transferred to the variable X, and whatever the value of X is now goes to the value of Y. That means both the values are interchanged. So just compile this code. So I have compiled this code. Now you can print both the variables X comma Y. So you can just run this statement. Okay. So now you can see that both the values are changed. So above, if you just analyze, the value of X is integer, that is 10, and Y is floating. So now, what will be the value of X? That is the floating, and what will the value of Y? That is the integer. So from a single line of code, we can just swap the variable. So here we can see that how easy is to code in Python programming. So that is the most basic feature of Python.
I hope you are able to do it. Can you please try?
Okay, so guys, it's now time for a quiz. So just one question. Okay, so there is one query.
So it's a quiz time. Get ready and use your chat box to answer.
Okay, so sorry, yes. Okay, good. Okay, so be prepared for quiz. Okay guys, so please be ready. This is a very simple and basic question. So what is the output of the following code? So three variables are already defined, P, Q, R. Okay, so is equal to 10, 20 and 30. So you have to print all the three variables. So what will be the output? Three options are there. First is 10, 20, second 10, 20, 30. Or it will show some error. You can use your chat box, you can use your question answer. Yeah, great.
One answer is coming up. How about the rest? Can you guys quickly answer? What is the output? Which is the right option?
Okay, B, Francis. Okay, B.
So what is the correct answer?
Sir, B is the correct answer.
Okay, great. So good, sorry, Francis, Soumya, well done.
Okay, so we are coming back to our Python programming. We are coming back to our Google Colab. So I think everyone is just clear up to this point that, recap what we have done. We have just learned that how to write simple print statement, how to declare variables, how variables can assign values, and how swapping of variables can be done. So we have done with this part. Now we are just printing the value in formatted form. Just give me 1 minute. Okay, so next is how to print the value in formatted form. So there are one more way to print the value, to use the format specifiers. I guess we are just aware of the format specifiers, that for integers we use %d, for a string we use %s, and for floating we use %f. So simply just write on the way print and then pass the arguments. So in between this parenthesis, we have to pass arguments. Just write in the single quote or double quotes, you can use anything. So I have to print X, Y, and Z value. So now, in the above, if you see just above this print statement, we have swapped the variable. So now the value of X will be floating. So here I am writing %f. What is the reason? Because after swapping of two variables, X and Y, their values are changed. Now X contains 67.89, that is the floating point number. So because that is the reason I have written %f. And next is the Y. So for Y, you are using what? Y value is now integer value. So just write %d, give some space, then write %s for the string, because you have taken the Z. You can also check from this type of Z, that is a string, because we have taken Guni in the Z, we have taken as a string. Then, okay. So now, what we have to write, percentage and the variable name, that is X, Y, comma, Z. That's all. So just execute, run this program, this one line code, but you will get the same output. The value of x is printed. So what is the value of x? It is the floating point number. So I have written %f, that is the format specifier. So now y, that is the integer, so it has returned 10. And z is the string that has returned guni. So f, it will return the six decimal places. That means the 6 points after your decimal number, after your the six numbers after decimal point. So in this way, you can also print the variables by using the format specifier. Please type this code and just execute this one line code. Yeah, definitely. I will repeat this explanation part. So actually, you have seen that we have just declared three variables. We have taken three variables in the first example, x, y, and z. Now, what we did with x, y, and z, in this part, what we have done? Swapping of variables. Now the value of y and x is interchanged. Initially, we have taken x is equal to integer number, but after swapping, the value of x becomes floating number. So I have to just print the variables x, y, and z. So what is another way to print? One way is to print simply, you can write print parenthesis x, y, z. You can pass the three arguments. Now, you can also just print in this way. So what is this x? X is a floating point number. So you can give the precision. So that is the f. Then what is the y? Y is an integer number. So you have written %d. So d stands for integer. And z is a string. So we have written s for the string. So this is the format. Now you just simply execute this program, one line of code, you will see the output that three variables are just, we have just printed the values of three variables, x, y, and z. I hope this is clear to everyone. Okay, sorry, we're showing an error. Can you please paste your code here? Yeah, sorry. Can you please paste your code here? And what about the other participants? Are they getting it? If you put double quotes, do you get the same name? Yeah, definitely. You can just do experiments with your bunch of lines of code. So that's why the programming is a fun. You can just do different experiments with your code. And now you can just see what kind of output it is generating. So there is a question that if we just replace the single quotes by double quotes, so what will happen? So let's see what will happen. It will be the printing same variables. So I have already explained this in the first statement, in the first program that we have written, print. I have written in single quotes and both, as well as in the double quotes. So in both the cases, the output will be same. So you can use any one of this. Okay. So I'm moving to the next part. So there is one more query in the chat box. Okay. Sorry to %d, d, f, d, and s. Yes, order. It will show the same output. It will show you the correct output. Okay, so I'm just moving to the last part of print statement. So that is the last way. For example, how to print manually. So for example, there is a very simple way. I'm just concatenating two or more strings to just make a one line statement. For example, I'm just writing print. So I am writing print and I have to pass arguments in between this parenthesis. So I am writing hello everyone. Hello everyone. So this is a sort of string. So what you are just writing in single quotes or double quotes, it is a string. So I have to concatenate two or three strings. So I am writing hello everyone and from. So in case of string, if you just want to join together two or more strings, then it is possible with the help of plus sign. So whenever we are talking about strings, plus is used for a concatenation symbol. So I'm writing, I have taken a string, hello everyone, then plus. So I have written from, okay, from is a second string. Then again, I am writing plus. That means a string concatenation. Now, I have to print a statement, hello everyone from Guni family. So, Guni is a string that I have taken in the variable above. So, I have taken Guni variable. Guni is the value of a variable Z. So, I am using the Z variable. So, Z is actually a string. So you have to specify the data type. So I'm writing this str. Str indicates string. So I'm using the variable z. Now, plus family. Okay. So this is the code. So in this line of code, what I have written, there is a simple print statement where two or more strings are concatenated and finally one line is printed. Okay, so when you just run this code, so you can see what is the output. Hello everyone from Guni family. So hello everyone is the string. String, that means however you writing in the single quotes, it will be printed as it is. So whatever you are writing in double quotes, it will be printing as it is. So hello everyone is printed, then plus. So plus is the string concatenation operator. That means you are joining two or more strings. So that is to join operation. Now, in double quotes, you have written from. So from is printed. But now next, you are taking the value from the variable Z. So in Z, Z is of string type. So it has printed Guni. It has taken the variable from the Z, taken the value from the Z variable. And finally, again, we have concatenated with plus. And we have write family in the double quotes. So this will be the output. But here in the output, you can see there is no space. So we can also add space. So where we have to add space in between everyone and from and Guni, Guni and family. So what we have to do, just add after this plus, you can add for spacing this double quotes, just give a space, then again add the plus symbol, and once again you have to give a space between from and str. So once again after this plus, you have taken a space, then again plus, then you have also to display a space between Guni and family. So you are also taking space, then again plus for the string concatenation. So what is the output? Hello everyone from Guni family. So you can see the output, you can see, analyze the changes. So what we have did earlier, we have used the plus. Plus is used for string concatenation. The one thing you should focus on, that this value of this z variable is taken from this, the value of z that we have taken earlier. So Guni is taken from the z variable. Rest, it is printed as it is. And after that, I have just given a space in between the two words. So it is the method to print manually. Okay, so there are two queries. What is the other way of writing the same statement? Can I write everything in the same quotes? Soumya, you are talking about which statement? Print manually or...
What is the other way of writing the same statement? Can't I write everything in the same quotes without spacing? So she is talking about the statement where we have done the concatenation.
Okay. If you don't provide space, then no space is provided, but it is actually, the line is printed, the string is concatenated, but without spacing.
Yes.
Okay, so everyone has executed this line of code. Okay, so I'm moving to our next part. Okay, so now the next part is how to take the input from the user. Because up to now, what we have taken, we have just taken the variables and passes the values to their variables. But what happens, suppose I'm taking a value from some user. So there is in some way. So for example, I'm taking a variable x, and I want that you user, that any user can take the value, can input any value. So I'm taking x input, and I'm just printing a message as a string, enter the number. So that's all. That is the way to print. So what I have taken? So if you want to take in some input from user side, so there is a statement, there is a function to be used, input. So that you have, once you have just familiar with the print function, same as it is the input function. So input function helps to take some input from the user. So after taking input from the user, you are assigning the value to some variable x. So whatever the value you are just taking from the user, it is stored in the variable x. So I'm just executing this statement. Okay, so it is asking for any number. So suppose I'm taking any number 12, just press enter. Okay, so that's all. So this is a very simple way to how to take your input from a user. So I have taken input from a user by the input function and passed this value to a variable x. Everyone done? Because the next line that I'm going to just type, it is a very important concept in Python. So
We have to wait. It is, you know, we have to wait for some time. I guess they are just getting into.
Yes, sir. Definitely, sir.
Yeah. So what Prof was showing, you know, is a user-defined function as how you can take the dynamic input from the end user.
Okay. Sorry. So it's a yes. Okay. Good.
Okay. So are we all able to do it? Sorry says yes. What about the rest? Soumya, Francis, Galaxy, Samsung Galaxy. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, great.
Okay, agreed. Fine. So I guess let's move on.
Okay. So that is the way to how to make a user-defined function. Okay, how to take a dynamic value. Now, again, you have used the type function to check the data type of variable. So again, I am checking. Now, there is a big difference you can just analyze. When I am writing type of X, so once you run this code, you will see, okay, any guesses what will be the output? I'm not just executing this code. So can you please write down in the chat box, what will be the output for this line type X? X is the variable that we have taken earlier. Int, yeah. Yeah, Francis and Sori have replied integer, but actually when you type this, execute this program, you will see that it is of string type, okay? So that is the most important concept in Python. You have to just make one thing very much clear. When you are taking input from the user, everything will be stored as an string data type. Indeed, you are just giving 12 number as an integer, but still, somewhere in Python, it is storing as an string data type. So there is a difference. I'm just writing 1-2 lines of code, then you will just able to understand. I have taken the value X is equal to 10, okay? So I am executing this. And I'm writing this type X. Okay, so now what is the type X? What is the type of X variable? That is an integer. But then, I'm sorry, I have to add this code here. But when I'm saying that X is equal to input, and I'm asking for a user to enter the number, enter any number, and then I'm saying type of X. So what is the output? First it is asking for a number. So then it is printing str. So this is the major difference. Whenever you are taking a variable and assigning any value, it is taking the same data type. For example, if you have taken float, I'm changing this value to 10.89. And then look what happens. The data type is changed float. But when you are taking some number from the user, you are taking some input from the user, everything is stored as a string. So there is a way to convert this string. So there is a way, for example, I am writing the same line, X is equal to input. So before input, if I write integer and pass the same line as an argument to an integer, now see what will happen. First, it will ask for any number. I have writing 17. So now the data type is changed. What is the data type? Integer. So why this happens? Because actually Python is a, high level programming language, but it is also an object oriented language. So it is an object-oriented language and a functional programming language. So in object, every object that we are just pass It is stored as object, and whenever you are taking input, so the every input is stored as a string. So once you just, for example, one more example we can also take. Okay, so I am taking x is equal to 10 and y is equal to 20. I have taken two numbers. So here I have taken two numbers, and suppose I am doing any calculation. So I am printing x comma y. Sorry, you can also take one step. Okay, so you are printing x comma y. So what is the result? That the two numbers are added and the result will be the addition of two numbers. But when we are just taking two numbers from user, it will show what kind of output it will show. You can see. So I'm taking x is equal to, I have writing simply input, and enter the value of x. Okay, so I'm taking the next variable y is equal to input, enter the value of y. So I have taken two variables from the user. Okay, so it will ask for two values. I'm taking two values, 12 and 13. Okay, so when you are writing for this, I'm editing in the same lines of code. So what is the type of x and what is the data type for y? You can see it is asking for any value. I'm taking two values, x and y, 13 and 14. Now the two types are printed. Okay, so it has printed because in one cell you can print only one. So it has printed x is equal to string. So whenever just I'm saying, and now I want to add x and y, because both the data types are string. So what will happen? Suppose I'm saying print x comma y. I'm taking the same numbers, 12 and 13. You can see what is the output, x plus y. I have already discussed where we have discussed printing the manually, printing any statement manually. So we have used the plus. So what is x data type? It is in string, y is an also string. So when it, we have used plus in between two strings, so it is in string concatenation. That means first string, first value 1, 2 is printed, and then concatenation, that means after first value, the next value is printed, 1, 2, 1, 3. So you can just, you have to clear up in mind that both the values, both the statements are just giving the different results. If you are assigning, if you are taking some variables and assigning some values, then you can perform some mathematical calculations, you can perform any arithmetic operations. But once you are taking values from the user, so you have to first convert it into an integer before converting some, before just going for any calculations. So here I can do one thing. I can take input. So before input, I'm just converting this string value to integer, nothing else. So now x and y value are converted from string to integer. Now again I am compiling this code. Now see what will happen. So again I am printing the same values. I am taking the same values 12 and 13. Now see what is the output. Now when you are just summing up both the values, the result is 25. And in case you are not converting this string into integer data type, so what is going to be happened here? The string is concatenated. Two strings are concatenated. So earlier the result was 12 and 13. Now the result is changed. It is automatically, it has give the result after addition of two values. So
this is called type casting, right?
Yeah. Yes.
If you just look at the first line, input entered the value of x, actually this argument is of the type string. But then what we did, just in the outer bracket, we forced to convert that string into integer. And that's the reason when you take up this print statement, instead of taking the string as 1, 2, it takes up 1, 2 as a integer, and that it adds to the value, which is also been typecasted to the integer, and eventually we get the result 25. I hope you guys can just try, right? Do we have a quiz, Professor? Because now it is 8 minutes left, and then we have to also sum up as what we have learned, right?
Okay. Yeah, definitely, sir. I guess there is a one quiz question from this. I'm just looking for this.
Yes.
Yeah, guys, please be ready for the quiz. That is a very simple question that we have already just did. What is the output of the following code? So you have taken already three variables, where 1, where 2, and where 3. So where 1 and where 2 are assigning the integer variables, values, and the in where 3 we are storing the string type, data type. So what happens when we write print statement print var plus var 2 plus var 3? So what will be the output? There are again four options for you. 6, 33, 1, 2, 3, or it might be some error.
So use your chat box to select the right option.
It's C. Yes, Soma is saying that the answer might be C.
How about others? Okay. Sorry,
says B. Sorry, saying B.
Mm-hmm. Come on, guys.
You can also use your Google Colab. You can also execute this four lines of code and you can just tell me the answer.
Okay.
Sorry, B. Francis, I think D, because we have where 1, not where.
So now you can announce the answer and the reason.
Okay. So actually the answer is error. So because one thing here Francis has very rightly said, because here where 1, we have taken where 1, and in the print statement I have written where. And what happens, suppose I am just changing this where to where 1. So now what will happen? Up to this we are correct. Francis is very much correct, that we have written in the print statement where, and we have taken the variable above where 1. Okay, so what happens if I am changing where to where 1 in the print statement? So what will happen? Now what is the output? So any guesses, please? So just give me a minute, I will just change there. Okay, so now I have changed the value, that is the verb 1. Now can you tell me what is the output again?
Come on, guys, quick. We have few minutes left. So post to this quiz, Professor, please recap as what we have learned.
Okay. Right?
Yeah.
So first, I'm just going to tell you the answer of this question.
Yes.
Again, in this case, it will be shown as an error, because once we are just we are taking two variables of integer type, and the third variable is of string type, so it is not concatenated. So first we have to convert this var1 and var2 either to integer type or var3 to some data type integer type. So there are two options. Either we have to convert var1, var2 to string data type, or we have to convert this var3 to integer data type. So it will show an error that mixing operators between numbers and strings are not supported. Okay.
Great.
So I'm just concluding this session. So please have a quick recap what we have done. Okay, so that's our agenda we have already discussed. Now, what is our learning outcomes that we have just want you to familiar with the basics and understanding of basic Python. And just very quick aware of the basic programming in Python. So in programming, what we have did, so we are just make you aware of print statement and variables, how to declare variables in a multiple declaration, as a multiple declaration, how to define the type of data type of variables, how swapping of variables is done, and how we can do print the values in the manually as well as in the formatted form. And the most important part, that how to take input from a user and what is your typecasting and how you can just convert the string into some other data types. So that we all have discussed in today's session.
Yes, so it is just the beginning, and we could able to only touch upon the most basic elements.
Yeah.
In fact, the condition statements, looping, file handling,
yes,
and many more powerful concepts are yet to come, that needs a lot of time, right? And you guys need to really go and enroll to the course if you want to deep dive into Python. But I guess it is good to go. Attendees, we request if you can quickly put your feedback for the session right in the chat, would enable us to understand how do you find the today's session. That is my our first question. So did you learn out of this? You guys can just utilize the chat and let us know quickly. That I hope this session remains, you know, helpful to kickstart your basics with the Python. Thank you, Francis.
Yeah, Francis, yeah. Thank you so much for your response.
How about others? Soumya, sorry. We hope that at least we could able to show you the path and the platform on which you guys can take this journey further. So we leave it at this point, correct? Also, if you guys are interested, you can show your interest. If you want to take up the course on the Python, you can put your interest, either say yes or maybe. And then, you know, our team will get back to you. It would be great to recommend a reading material. Yep, if you can share some link.
Yeah, Francis, I definitely I can share you some links. First, actually, there is a sheet, the collab sheet, which I have prepared. So I can definitely share with you. For that, I need your mail IDs. And once you have any query, so I'm just dropping out my mail ID in the chat box.
If everyone was teaching in a simple way like this, the professor and student would not be. Yes, yes, thank you. Thank you so much, Soumya. We don't want, you know, that's the artistic way of a teaching that should not create, any fear of learning. Rather, it should transform the students, should build the confidence. So we hope that this session has at least helped you to move out your fear of the programming. And the professor has taken us to a fantastic journey and at least made our life easy by showing and kickstarting how can we write a small piece of code. So thank you guys. Thank you all for joining us. And that's the end of today's session. So all the best. Over to you, panelist.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yep.
Thank you so much, Tanvi ma'am. Thank you so much, Hebel sir, for having a wonderful session on Python. As suggested, this is just an overview of Python. To deep dive into further details, you need to contact to Christine. So you all need to contact Christine for the course regarding entire information of the course. And as suggested, for the reading materials, I guess, Tanvi ma'am, you can give it to me. I could pass it further.
Definitely.
Yeah, that could be taken ahead, and that will be a lot of help to the students as well. Thank you so much. We conclude and see you tomorrow at the same time, 11:30. And tomorrow's thing is on spreadsheet analysis. So looking forward to see you all, 11:30 it is. Bye. Yeah.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
Have a nice day.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Malik, we can conclude, please.
Yes, ma'am.